Human touch. Okay, before we move on to human touch, let me tell you about one thing which had intrigued me a lot. I had this relative, a little elder than me and all that. She finished her studies with that, and then she got married to a guy in USA, and she shifted to the US. Initially, she was a homemaker. She had a child, all those things. She was looking after all these things. After things settled down and she had that empty nest and all that, she decided, let me get into some activity. So she decided to become a real estate agent in the city where she was in USA. And this I'm talking about maybe 20 years back. Okay. Now what would happen is that the city being very big and commuting, but like what we see today in cities like Bangalore or anywhere, thing was that people used to find it difficult to commute long distances. So most of the real estate agents, what they had done at that time was videos and visuals and all that had suddenly become very popular and easy. They started giving virtual tours of the houses. So you want to buy a house, this real estate agent would take a video of, you know, the house from outside, and then the camera walks in. And they show, this is the kitchen, this is the hall, this is the bathroom, this is this, all that would be done. And then they would say, okay, now if you're interested, you let us know and things of that sort. So it had made things very easy. But this girl, she was a typical Indian. So she felt that, you know, the human touch is lacking. I mean, you are buying a house is something which, where probably you're going to live the rest of your life. It's going to be your home. It's not a business thing or something else that you are buying. It's a place which you're going to call home. Your family is going to live there. So she started talking to them and said that, see, I know that it is inconvenient. You have to drive all the way. Once you come over there, you may realize that, no, this house is not really suitable. So you wasted your time and all that. But I still feel that I would like you to come with me. We'll go there. You'll get a feel of that place. She used to say that, you know, you touch that house, you feel that house, you smell that house and decide. And believe me, she became one of the most successful and popular real estate agents. Because people saw that human touch in her. So even though that facility was there, that you could watch videos sitting at home and things of that sort, they started contacting her rather than the other agents who would first show them videos and then say, if you're interested, then I will show you the house or something of that sort. She would straight away say, I would like to talk to you. I'll find out what your interests are. And the moment I find that, okay, this seems to suit you or that seems to suit you, I will suggest that we go on this little thing. And the interesting and the funny part is that moving on from just showing the houses, she also became a de facto counselor. Because this person would come and then, you know, the husband and wife would start arguing in front of her about which house is better and what is good and what is bad. And then she would try to, you know, pacify them and mediate between them. And then afterwards, the wife will call up and say, oh, I'm so sorry, my husband behaved very badly. And then she would say, no, it's okay. But I understand that, you know, you have to undergo all these things. You have to be very tolerant of your husband. All these things started off and she started enjoying so many things. Now, why am I telling you this story? Because when we said lockdown and we said that everything has to be virtual, people stopped having that personal touch. People stopped moving out of their houses. People stopped, you know, connecting with others, people stopped going to people, and most important, people stopped, you know, even going close to somebody or shaking hands with somebody and something of that sort. Of course, there are reasons for it. The government did bring in rules and regulations. We were told that, you know, because of this pandemic and things of that sort, we have to maintain social distance. We should not, you know, touch each other and those sort of things. But what I am thinking, what I started, you know, reviewing as the days went past. Let's say you're a family of three people, six people, whatever it is. You live together in the same house. And can you maintain social distance from each other? Can you ensure that every time you are 2 meters away, you carry one measuring tape between you and your spouse or your child or your mother-in-law or something? And with mother-in-law, maybe if some of you may like to do it, that's a different matter. But are we not taking the letter of the law more important than the spirit of the law? This guideline or this rule which was brought in by the authorities was to tell you that you go out, maybe you go to a shop or you go to a mall or you go wherever you go, you meet some outsider. You don't know, he may be COVID positive. Now, if you go too close to him, if you shake hands or if you touch him or something of that sort, that COVID may transfer on to you. So that was the reason why these things were, these guidelines were given. And many, many times, even now, authorities are saying, maintain that guideline. Put on the mask, use the sanitizer, wash your hands, and sing happy birthday to you twice while you're washing your hands to ensure that the virus gets washed out. Even for that, somebody made a very nice wisecrack that a virus which can be washed away by, 20 seconds of soap hand washing, why do we need one full year to develop a vaccine for it? Anyway, that's in the lighter. Then the fact is that, yes, COVID is serious. It is a virus. It is a ailment. In the extreme case, it can even be fatal, as you know. Though, thankfully, the numbers are very few, but there have been deaths. People have lost their life. Some people went through a very, very bad time also when they had to be hospitalized, they had to be put in the ICU and things of that sort. Yeah, acknowledge that, and I'm not trying to belittle that. But what did we do in terms of maintaining our sanity, maintaining our social contacts, maintaining our understanding of people? Just to give you an example, there was this person who said that my parents live maybe, in the next lane or 5 minutes from my house. But I haven't visited them for so many months because they are old. I don't want to give them COVID. Now, I was trying to visualize, put myself in the shoes of, let's say, her father. Maybe he is 80 years old or whatever it is. When you come to that age, have you been able to sympathize what life is for a person who has come to, let's say, 80 or 90 years, whatever, maybe his age? What does that person want? Does that person want to live for another 30 years? Does that person want to ensure that I do not get any form of disease or something? But does that person want to have the warmth and care of his loved ones? His world has already shrunk. He has retired 20 years back. Not only he doesn't have office colleagues and all that, maybe even his juniors have retired by now, so he doesn't have anybody to look back to. Most of his neighbors and these and that think he's too old, and that's why they don't connect with him. He may even be having a few good friends, but they live far away and they've got their limitations. Somebody's got arthritis, somebody is not mobile, somebody doesn't have a vehicle to move around or whatever it is. So he can't even meet his friends whom he cares for. And now if we say that, no, I am not going to visit my own father, mother, because I don't want to give COVID, that makes me question this very basic, principle. And that is what I said, that are we, sticking to the letter of the law? Okay, we did it. As you know, we have already completed an anniversary of 23rd March 2020 when the lockdown was imposed, extended, and then slowly unlock 1.0 and unlock 2.0 started coming in. People got scared. People felt that they may not be able to, do things for a long, long time. As the lockdown unlock started, people still kept getting hearing about known people or even unknown people who have come down with COVID, and that scared them so much that we didn't want to take any chance. Schools, of course, have been happily closed for the last 13, 14 months now. All that went on. Just when it was looking that, okay, January onwards, we got a vaccine. Very soon we'll all be vaccinated and then we will not have to worry about COVID. The numbers have come down. Even without the vaccine, the numbers had started coming down, down, down. And we said, ha, the worst is over. Now things are going to be fine. And just when that was happening, you know what has happened in the last couple of weeks. Again, the whole cycle seems to be repeating itself. And this repeat, my gut feeling is, will go on and on. People are talking about connecting virtually and not physically as the new normal. They are talking about online classes and banning offline classes as the new normal. Even the word offline is connected to the word line. If I want to have classes, if I want to connect to somebody, if I want to interact with another human being, why is line a part of it? Line meaning technology. Technology has come in only in the last few years. People like me have lived in that era when there were no smartphones, there were no mobile phones, there was no, what do you call those, 100 channels of TV, there was no, you know, no Flipkart, there was no Netflix. Even the ITI black phones with a dial on it were a rarity. Only, you know, few people could afford to have that or use that or whatever it is. We went through that era and we did go through it happily. Just to give you an example, in November, I went out to a very small remote place beyond Doddalapur. I spent 2 days, the free time, you know, in between the training or whatever other work that I had, I spent some free time walking around the place. I saw very old people. I saw the normal working age group of people, 20, 30, 40, 50. I saw children. I was amazed when I was looking at them. When a city like Bangalore seems to have so many restrictions, so many fears, so many days, everybody wearing masks and the marshals finding you if you are found, even to have a mask which has slipped down from your nose or something of that sort. And you know what I found there? I found the only people who are wearing a mask were the people at the bus stop. And I asked, why? They said, because the RTC bus conductor will not allow us to get into the bus unless we are wearing a mask. Only for that purpose they were wearing a mask. Nobody else was wearing a mask. Okay. Then immediately, obviously, the next question that came is, these people are so irresponsible. These people are roaming around. They are touching each other. They are doing, you know, being so close to each other. They are not washing hands. They are not. They haven't heard of a thing called sanitizer and all that. COVID must be rampant over there. So I kept asking, do you know anybody in your village or your locality or your relatives who has got COVID? And they turned around and said, what is COVID? Nobody seemed to have had COVID over there. So what does it mean? It means that the human element should never ever be subservient to any technology, any disease, anything of that sort. We have to look at what we can do to improve and build our quality of life. One of the things which I have been saying for years and decades, and I say it particularly to youngsters, because somewhere I feel that if we can change youngsters, it's far better than trying to, you know, break your head against the elders who already have certain fixed opinions. Sometimes I do find that the youngsters do listen. Even if they don't listen at that moment, there's a long-term impact, you know. Much later, they go back and think, and then they change their lives or something of that sort. So, one of the things that I've always been saying is, please have a mind of your own. Do not go by this herd mentality. Do not get taken in by peer pressure. Now, today, as adults, are we not all going under the peer pressure of the social media? We want to believe. Every now and then somebody comes out with something saying that, you know, a new regulation has come in. You know, this is what happened. You know, that is, what is your source? Social media, nothing else. Has been told by some authority, some person who has the power to convey that, or the authentic information or knowledge to be able to convey that. Has somebody done that? No. But we are not able to differentiate. Then, what about meeting people, interacting with people? If I cannot interact, if I cannot go close to my own loved ones, what sort of a life am I leading? If I am going to maintain 2 meter distance from my father, mother, son, daughter, even though I'm living 24/7 with them, is that a quality of life? What have we done to ourselves? What the pandemic has done is only perhaps 10-20% of what we have done to ourselves. We have created a much worse situation than what the pandemic has done. And are you aware of it? If you are aware of it, then I want to give you a few tips which I want you to think of. What is wrong in keeping in touch with people? Let us say, okay, I'll grant you, let's do it online only, virtually. Ask yourself this in the last 1 year, knowing fully well that we have had lockdowns, we have had pandemics, we have had this fear of people isolating themselves, people have lost jobs. All this has happened. Children are sitting at home, not able to go to school and things of that sort. Now, with all that going on, what efforts have you made? Sorry to be a little more direct and blunt or whatever you want to call it, but have you made that effort to reach out? Many months back, when I was speaking on the same forum of the FB webinar of Saturday, I had asked, can you please start calling up, go through your phone directory. You will find the number of a carpenter who had come and done a good job for you 3 years back. You have not deleted his number because you feel that if by chance you or somebody needs some carpentry work, you should keep his number. You haven't met him, you haven't spoken to him for 3 years. It was fine because those 3 years he went about doing his own work. He had his family, he had his customers, he had his contracts. So he was busy. Whether you call him or not, or whether you, you know, inquire about him or not, doesn't make a difference to him. But do you realize what this guy must have gone through when the lockdown came in? He's a carpenter. He works on day-to-day contracts. People call him, give him some money and tell him, make this table, make this cupboard, make this thing. He makes it and he makes his money. He works hard. He earns a pretty decent amount also because, you know, very skilled carpenters are far and few between. So he has established his name. But when the lockdown came, that was the end of his income, his contracts, and also his basic self-esteem. Who am I and what am I? What am I?
Sorry.
Is it ready or not?
Ready.
I just wanted to share with you something which you have 100% seen more than once, but probably at that time it was only an abstract thought. And you admired it and left it. I want to connect it up to real life today. Guruji Rabindranath Tagore, 100 years back. More because of the fact that we were going through slavery. But slavery by a foreign government. and slavery by COVID is the same to the mind. So Guruji said, where the mind is without fear and the head is held high, where knowledge is free, not schools shut down, where the world has not been broken up into fragments of 2 BHK, 3 BHK, nobody enters into my building, nobody goes into this condominium, nobody goes lock down all the malls and shopping centers, etc., by these narrow domestic walls. Their words come out from the depth of truth, where tireless striving stretches its arm towards perfection, where the clear stream of reason has not lost its way into the dreary desert sand of dead habits and social media, where the mind is led forward by thee into ever-widening thought and action. Into that heaven of freedom, my father, let my country awake. Guruji Rabindranath Tagore said that 100 years back. It is more relevant today than it was almost 100 years ago. What are we doing by trapping ourselves into these fragments? What are we doing by locking up our minds? Authorities only told us to lock ourselves up from physical attraction of a virus which can be destructive. But nobody told us to lock up our minds, no. Did you ever come across a government order or something saying, please maintain social distance between your mind and somebody else's mind? That we have done. I saw a very sweet video the other day. Normally, I don't get into all these forwards and this and that. But when I saw this, I was so touched. There's a gentleman who said, who narrated an incident from his childhood. He said, when I was a small boy, I did not have a cycle. And I had a friend who had a cycle. And I used to really look at that cycle with a lot of yearning that I wish I had a cycle. One day, that friend, who was a very generous and a sweet boy, he came to me and said, I'll lend you my cycle. Keep it for the whole day. Tomorrow, I'll come and take it back. Enjoy yourself. He said, I was thrilled. I was so happy. The whole day, I left everything else. And I cycled and cycled and cycled all over the neighborhood. Till it became too dark and too late. And my mother was shouting at me. So I came back, kept the cycle safely in the garage, and went to sleep. He said, the next morning, I woke up very sad, because I knew that my friend will come now and take away this cycle. Though yesterday was one of the more happiest days that I had, today is one of the saddest days because the cycle will go away. So I didn't even want to go into the garage and look at the cycle, because it will only remind me of the fact that any minute now he's going to come and take it away. So I sat, I sulked. I waited for my friend to come. I didn't even do any other enjoyable activity. And the whole day went past. My friend didn't come. I went to sleep. Third day, I got up. Again, feeling, oh, yesterday he didn't come. Now he must be coming any minute. Now he must be coming, etc., etc. And therefore, I didn't use the cycle. Because if I take out the cycle and I try riding it, and at that moment he comes and says, give me my cycle, I'll feel even more hurt, no? So that's why I didn't take out that cycle. The fourth day, I didn't use the cycle. And I was very sad. After 4 days, my friend came and said, I'm taking the cycle. And I said, thank you to him. And he went away. He connects, this friend of mine who sent this video, he connects that to real life. In Hindi, we say, no, Zindagi char din ki hai. Life is but 4 days. These 4 days, when I had the cycle, I did not use it and I was miserable. He said, this is what we do with life. We have these 4 days of life, but we are so scared of death. We are so scared of life being taken away from us that today when we have the life, we have the cycle, it is there in our mind, we can ride happily on it, but we don't live it. That is the theme of what I want to share with you today. Please give it a thought. I have some more points, something relevant to convey to you. It's just food for thought. I'm not imposing anything. I'm not saying that you have to, you know, agree with my way of thinking. It's just a few thoughts. I will share that with you. And I will just hand over to Purni for a couple of minutes. She's got some very nice musical way of conveying to you about the human touch. Let her do that and be ready with your questions. And we'll have an open house as always, and we'll have a wonderful dialogue. So here is Purni with her musical thoughts.
Hi guys, good morning. I am a Bollywood movie song buff, okay? So I like to listen to a lot of songs there while I'm adjusting also myself on the camera so that I'm seen properly. Okay, so when we were, you know, talking about this topic of touch being such an integral part of our lives, be it social, be it emotional, I was just thinking of a few songs. So possibly some of you all have, you know, heard these songs. But even if you have not heard, at least from the lyrics, you will be able to, you know, understand that what is it that innumerable songs in Bollywood communicate to us about the importance of touch. One of them, it is a very old song, you know, where the child tells the mother, the song goes like, I'm not that great in, you know, the tunes or something, but I'll, the lyrics, through the lyrics, I think we'll be able to understand. It says, माँ मुझे अपने गले से लगा ले आंचल में छुपा ले के और मेरा कोई नहीं. That is, माँ मुझे अपने गले से लगा ले. Give me a nice tight hug. Aanchal. Aanchal is that, you know, you take the child close to yourself and you keep the child with you. He's saying, Aanchal mein chupa le. So the child says that you hide me inside the aanchal so that I feel safe and secure. That is the importance of touch. I'll give you one more song, which is, that's very cute actually. That goes totally on social distancing. This person says, Dur reh kar na karo baat, kareeb aa jao. He's saying, what's the point? You are so far, far away. Doesn't make any sense for me. Please come closer so that we can have a better dialogue. Think about it, that it's not that this has just come out of the, you know, flash and songs have just come out. There has been importance and necessity of touch, be it emotional or be it social. And when we talk of emotional, you know, closeness and emotional touch, which is so important for our own mental well-being, one of the other songs which comes to my mind is Chhukar mere man ko kiya tumne kya ishaara, badla ye mausam lage pyara jag saara. That is, Chhukar mere man ko, you have touched my heart. And that is the necessity of so many people, that, you know, we touch their hearts. How? With, you know, being emotionally close to them. And that is what we, you know, I thought these songs were, yeah, Jennifer, it's your favorite song. Glad to know that. And it is a very popular one also. So these are the songs which, and innumerable ones. I'm sure next time when you heard hear the word chhoo, or dur raho, paas aa jao, gale logo, you will understand what is the importance of touch in human life. In fact, Sonal, since you deal so much with children, Sonal deals a lot with children, and I'm sure she'll surely be able to tell us so much about the importance of touch.
Yes, when it comes to children, especially with the younger ones, touch does a lot of wonders, especially when they are, you know, upset, or you know, they don't want to, or they have been scolded by somebody else. Even if you don't have words, and if you think that if I speak, the child is not going to understand, just go and hold the child's hand. And if you see that the child is open, you can just, you know, give a hug. Immediately you see that the child is, you know, that emotion is melting down. Either the child will start crying, or the child will say, "You just leave me, I'm angry." The expression will come out. And if a child is a little older, hug is something they don't like when they are, you know, in that peak of the emotion. But even if you go physically closer, shows that you're close to the heart. You know, there are so many ways where you can show with the touch. And even by, you know, just keeping your hand forward, just bringing it closer, also makes a lot of change in them. You know, I am there with you. Even leaning forward can give them that, you know, I'm with you. And whatever work you are doing at home, if you can keep aside and just turn around and be there, that also gives a child with social, also you can do it with completely new people. But nowadays, that social distancing has been ingrained so much, it's like the moment some new person walks in, you go two steps behind. Not required. Keep your safety measures intact. Have your mask, wear your gloves. Keep safety measures intact, but don't make the other person feel unwelcomed. Make sure you are touching the heart, not only physically welcoming by just smiling, but walking two steps back. That's a confusion that you are giving to the child walking in. If you are smiling, might as well go two steps forward. Safeguard yourself, no doubt about it, but go two steps forward. Make the child feel welcome. Go down. And if the child is open to touch, give your hand to touch. That makes a lot of difference. And children especially, they love that touch of soft toys and soft things. The moment you touch, you will know that whether the child is, you know, angry or upset, the way the child reacts with the hand given to you will give you a lot of understanding about it. Try it out and see how it goes.
Yeah, absolutely. Yeah. Absolutely. And even an infant, you know, when they just put up their hands and you do like this, they hold it. And what is the impact it has on you when the child holds the hand? That is what is the impact of touch also so many times, right? And there was just one particular situation which I thought I'll just share with you. We are also a counseling house. I call it a counseling house because we are like a big family over here. So while we are a counseling house, I came across this lady who was with her husband only all the time at home. But purely because of the fears that she had, she ensured that, you know, her husband just never came even an inch closer to her. She would just leave his food on the table, not have even food with him. She would say, "No, you eat it and go." And not that he had anything or she had anything. And because of that, what happened is she knew that her relationship with her husband was actually going in for a toss. It was deteriorating day by day, day by day. But somehow that feeling that, no, I don't think I want to be even anywhere closer to this person. She had stopped speaking also to him, because that is what was the impact. And it took quite some Herculean efforts, if I may say, to, you know, ensure that we could make her see some light of the day, that, you know, what is more important. As Ali mentioned about the cycle story, and Surekha does have a question on the cycle, more on the cycle, and we will answer that. So maybe it's a good idea to answer everything together. So we will do that. By this, what has happened is that it was quite a thing, you know, they were not together, they were not doing things together, no touching, no emotional, and there was a very clear disconnect which had started happening. And to get that along took a very long time. At least there she took some help. She was seeking help. But in many cases, if help is not being sought, the impact and, you know, the time taken to really get things back into action, I think, can take a very, very long time. Right? Right, Sonal?
Yeah. Well, you were sharing, I was just thinking about one case that had come up over here. This child was unable to speak when she came, and she was around 4 or 5 years, but showing a lot of actions, communicating through a lot of actions, and those actions showed that, you know, don't come close to me. But later, with over the period of time, giving her comfort, respecting her way of being, slowly she was open to come by herself and sit in my lap. And when she sat in my lap, I could feel that lot of warmth from her. But she was just waiting for the right time when she could overcome whatever she was feeling, and when she felt trusted and accepted, only then she made her own attempt to come forward and sit on my lap. And when she came on the lap and she held my hand, just caressing it, I tell you, that feeling is something I cannot put in words. These are such experiences which are so rich to me that touches my heart. This is fantastic. Something I thought I must share, how it works, human touch.
In fact, talking about children, information which I would like to leave you all with is that at Banjara, we very firmly believe in reaching out emotionally and, developing life skills, which are so necessary for our healthy, happy, meaningful living. So we are very soon going to be announcing what we call as self-development, life skills development program. And we have right now decided to keep it online for the benefit of students and, you know, parents who may want the security of their children. And so I'll just leave you with that thought, what life skills are, what is this all about. We'll come to you very shortly and answering your questions. So put them all up. Is Ali over here?
Yes. Ah, I see a lot of Hi Purnima, lovely, my favorite song. You can ride a cycle well when you loosen your grip on the handle. How can we loosen our grip on life so that we ride life well? Wonderful question, Surekha, I think. It is true that we need to loosen our grip on life. What do we mean by loosen our grip? Not take life so seriously, but keep on thinking. Exactly like the message which this friend of mine said, all the time thinking seriously, this will happen, that cycle will go away, this thing will happen to me, or anything of that sort. So if we learn to, and one more way of losing that, loosening rather that grip on life and not taking seriously, is to get into the human touch. Technology is a wonderful slave, but a horrible master. And slowly, technology seems to be the only, friend that we are going to be left with. And that friend will really take advantage of you. That friend will overwhelm you, I can assure you of that. So where are we losing out on that human touch? I was giving you the example of a carpenter whom you know. In this last 1 year, did you make one phone call to him and say, Baba, I was thinking of you, how your life must be. You had told me that you've got 2-3 small children, or you've got an aged mother or something of that sort. I just wanted to find out how you are. No carpentry work right now, but I will, keep you in mind. I'm just giving that as an example to tell you how we can reach out to people, because otherwise we are isolating ourselves very badly. What about your old friends? friends with whom you used to meet, you used to interact with, maybe you used to go to a club, or maybe you used to, whatever it is. Now, with all these fears going on, what is happening? We are trying to avoid. Most of the family members are telling you, where it is not essential, don't go. Even if your club is open, where do you want to go and sit in the club? You don't know what is going to happen. But there are all those type of things. So when that sort of a thing is happening, if you do not want to have group activities, if you do not even want to have one-to-one activities, I am putting it to you, though very sadly, that at least are you connecting to people online? Though I don't believe in that. You ask me personally, I feel that nothing that can, replace human touch. So I'm not asking you to break rules. I'm not asking you to go against directives of the authorities and all that. But within that, what are we doing to ensure that we maintain existing relationships, we develop new relationships? If you go back to the pre-pandemic era, we used to inevitably every now and then make friends, isn't it? Now, what friends have you made in the last 1 year is my question. If you've done it, I'm very happy for you. So Vinita says, actually, my son also said that we must thank the Swiggy guys, delivery guys, etc. We have been doing regularly from the past 1 year, and the happiness on their face is priceless. Very, very true, Vinita. Thank you very much. I'm sure those guys must be really blessing you because of that little gesture of yours. In fact, Purni used to tell me about her mother ages ago in Bombay, where they used to live in a small apartment. Very, you know how Bombay houses and all that are. But she said any time a delivery guy came, any time a salesman came or something, she used to make it a point to either give him some buttermilk or some lime juice or something or the other and send him off because he's walking off into the hot sun. This is what builds relationships, and this is what makes you happy about what life is all about. We are on the one side becoming more and more and more, conscious that I have to protect from this, I have to protect from that. And I come to the most important thing. What are we as concerned adults doing about children? Children are social beings more than anything else. I am not concerned, and I'm not discussing portions, online exams, offline exams, all these type of things. They don't make any significance to me. But knowing that there is so much restrictions, knowing that we are depriving children of something that used to come naturally, ask your grandparents who grew up in a village. School may have been functioning, may not have been functioning. There were schools where there was only one teacher, and if that teacher didn't come, children would walk to the school, see that the teacher is not there, and start roaming around, go and see a herd of animals, go and pluck some flowers, go and help out somebody in a shop somewhere, and just roam around freely. But believe me, that was also learning. It did not mean that because the teacher was not there and no textbook lessons were taught, children did not learn. Children learned so much. In fact, I still remember the great scientist, M.S. Swaminathan. He went to a village once where they had to check a crop, where they were doing some experimental, farming or something of that sort. So they drove down, and they went over there to that village. They saw whatever was there and everything. They finished, and they were about to leave when the people over there, the organizers of the project, they said, "Sir, it's very far back to the city. It's getting on to lunchtime. We have prepared lunch. Just wait for a few minutes, half an hour, lunch will be ready. Have your lunch and go. Otherwise, on the way, it's going to be, quite late." He said, "It's fine." Because he had that half an hour, he started walking around the village. And before you know it, I told you how children are. Half a dozen children came behind him and started staring at him. He started chatting with them, asking them about things and all those sort of things. Ah, Suman has come out with a very good thing. My son always addresses delivery people or cab drivers as sir, and their eyes just light up. They feel so special talking to them in the little journey in the cab, and they feel special that somebody heard them out. Very true. So Mr. Swaminathan was, making some casual inquiries. And there was this girl, he said she must have been all of 11, 12 years of age. And this girl seemed to know everything about the flora and fauna. The moment he would look at a particular tree, she would give him all the information about that tree. The moment he would look at a crop, she would tell everything about the crop. She would talk about seasons, she talked about water supply, she would talk about wells and rivers and everything. And he was so impressed. He blessed her at the end of that half an hour and told her, take up science as a career, you will do very well in it. And this little one very shyly turned to him and said, Illa Swami, I am very poor at science. I always fail in science. So I am waiting. I don't want to study science, sir, she said. She fails in the textbook answers of science, but she excels in learning science in the real way. This, please do not neglect this aspect of children, whatever we do. Anushri says, in summer before pandemic, we used to give buttermilk to all the people who pass by our house, especially workers, sweepers. Fantastic, Anushri, I think. These are the small gestures, which I want to salute you people, whoever among you are doing it. And I know that there are a lot of people who are doing it. You are the role models for all of us. If we could emulate and we could also start doing similar things, I think that there is a lot that we can do. But one thing is for sure, because of the pandemic, because of the lockdowns, and I'm again telling you, we do not know where the future lies. I do not know. Today's newspaper said that the Chief Minister of Maharashtra said we may lock down the entire state. That is Maharashtra. We don't know what is going to happen in other places. So all I'm saying is that there are certain things which are not in our control. We do not know whether this pandemic will go away in the next few weeks or whether it will hang around for the next few years. We don't, but what we do know is whether we can free our mind from it. If we keep on thinking pandemic all the time, we are locking ourselves in. That's why I showed you the great poem of Guruji Rabindranath Tagore. Where the mind is without fear, that is what my concern is. And that can only happen if you connect to people. Please make simple efforts in whatever little way you can to ensure that you can be connected to people. Be connected to nature. Nature teaches us so much. Take the children out into nature. There's no lockdown. As I told you about that village where I was, if you can just take your children, drive down to a place like that and spend the whole day over there, I'm sure your children will not pick up COVID from there. But they will learn so much about life. In fact, we will learn so much about life. So this is my area of concern, and that is one of the reasons why we, selected this topic today. That keeping in account the fact that there is a second wave of fear, I won't even say second wave of the virus, I don't know anything about the virus, and I'm sure most of the doctors also don't know it. But taking that into account, what are we doing to ensure that we have some amount of connectivity to human beings? It is only our connection with human beings that can make us feel that life is good. The moment I have some problem, but I know that I have a friend, I can pick up that phone and talk to that person. And of course, if I have the courage, instead of talking to the person, if I can walk down to his house, go and sit with him and talk to him or her, I think that is something which you have to actually experience it and see the difference of what happens. So do I have any more questions on okay, while we wait for that, let me quote Henry Ford. You heard of him, no? Great man, not only because of his industrial or, you know, the car making business, but even as a person, there's a lot we can learn from him. He said, if there is any one secret of success, if there is any one secret of success, it lies in the ability to get the other person's point of view and see things from his angle as well as your own. Again, this is almost 100 years back. It is far more relevant today than it was that time. How do we make this effort to understand other people's viewpoints? If we lock ourselves and if we lock our minds in, we will lose that ability. We will not be able to do anything. I mentioned this earlier, I'm telling you again. When authorities want to really punish a convict, they put him in what is called solitary confinement. He has the same basic amenities as any other prisoner. In fact, he has the whole room that jail cell to himself. He doesn't have to share the space with somebody. He has the privacy. Nobody's shouting, nobody's screaming, nobody's snoring or anything. He has certain advantages. But it is the worst thing that you can do to a human being, because we are social animals. We need interactions. We need human contact. And here we are. We are not in a, what do you call it, a prison cell or something where physically we are being prevented from interacting with people. What are we doing in terms of interacting with people in every possible different way? There are so many ways in which you can do it. Let me give you one simple example. Long, long back in Mumbai, there was a school which wanted to take up an unusual project. And you know what they did? They called all the children. And based on their age and their capability of understanding, they made a project of understanding their locality. Okay? Starting with, one group was given the assignment, find out why our locality was named as whatever it is today. Another one was told, find out how many shops sell medicines and where are they located. Another one was told, find out how many barbers there are and where they are located. Another one was to find out, you know, which are the restaurants which sell South Indian food, North Indian food, or continental food. Which are the nearest ambulance services. And the children got so involved in that project, they went about finding every possible thing. And then the school arranged for a exhibition. They called the parents and other people and they said, see, children have made these charts. And here you are, at a glance, you can see the whole locality and everything that is available in the locality. And the rush was so great, you won't believe me. They had to extend that exhibition for one whole week, because people were just streaming inside. They said, we didn't know about this, about the locality. We didn't know that. We didn't know this. Then people from other localities started coming in to see, oh, what is this that is happening in your locality? I'm just giving you a very simple thing. Anything of that sort, use your creative brain and you can do so much about it. Right, Surekha is asking, how should a girl respond to her boyfriend who is unable to confront his parents about their relationship? She needs his human touch of understanding her pain. No, I'm a strong believer that, you know, as it is, you know that there is a strong gender bias in our society. A boy normally should have things much easier than a girl. If a girl says that I'm in love with this boy and this and that, the parents can get very strict and very nasty also at times. With a boy, generally, it cannot be so bad. So here is this guy who is not willing to tell his parents about his relationship. Do you really think this girl should marry this boy? Give it a thought. I'm not trying to condemn this particular boy, but I just want, see, most of these things, I only want you to stimulate your mind and think. The answer should be yours. If the girl says it's fine, I don't care, I will go ahead, I will run away with him without his parents' permission or whatever it is. That's their life and I have nothing to say. But just to understand human behavior, if this boy has grown up to become whatever, 20, 30, whatever his age is, And even today, he doesn't have that basic level of communication with his parents, where he can sit down and have a meaningful discussion why he feels that this girl would be an ideal life partner and seek their blessings. What has he learned about life skills? Forget about going out and making friends or understanding others. What has he achieved in terms of his basic relationship? And this, Surekha's question, highlights the fact that we are missing out on the human contact right at home, having been brought up by his own parents and living with them for years and decades. He still has not managed to develop a close enough communication, the freedom to discuss. Let them disagree, let them fight it out, let them say no, let them give reasons. He will say, why I want to marry this girl, he will give reasons. It can be an ongoing discussion, it can be an ongoing argument also. But this is exactly what we need to think of, that can we maintain better relationships post-pandemic, starting with our own nearest and dearest. Don't wait for a situation where you have to wait for something. Okay, Jennifer has asked, do you think Atmanirbhar Bharat is a good policy? Sorry to disappoint you, Jennifer. I do not go into policies and government matters and all that. I leave it to, we have an elected government, okay? We elect them every 5 years. So we deserve the government that we have got. When we elect a government, it is our duty to follow whatever they say, because we have an opportunity of getting somebody else into the or into the seat if we don't like them. So I don't even bother. I say, let them do what they want. You remember that great quote of Jesus Christ when people tried to trap him by saying that, you know, should we give taxes to Caesar, the king? And Jesus is supposed to have said, render unto Caesar what belongs to Caesar, and render unto God what belongs to God. Differentiate the two. So we will not get into this controversy whether this tax is correct, whether this policy is correct, or anything of that sort. At the same time, within the constraints of any policy, even policies which I disagree with and which I feel not good for us and things of that sort, what can I do in terms of creating my own little world by reaching out to people around us? That is my little world. I can't control the government, I can't control the country, I can't control the whole world, I can't even control my, maybe the area MLA or whatever it is. And I should not. Why should I get into that? What I should be doing is to reach out to as many people, wherever, whenever it is possible, and create that little nice, warm environment around me, that little world around me, which can be wonderful. Rima says, communication in any relationship is vital, be it emotional, social, etc. No doubt about it, Rima, but the only thing is that we need to practice. There is no substitute for practice. We have to. So can I leave you with this message that we are into the weekend? It is Saturday noon. Why don't you spend the rest of your weekend practicing whatever you have agreed with, whatever you feel has made sense to you, whatever you feel is applicable to you? Go ahead and put it into practice. There will be people who are ignorant, there will be people who are not enlightened, there will be people who disagree with you. It still doesn't matter. You start putting it to practice, be a role model, and before you know it, you will have people following you, at least a few of them. And then you will see the results for yourself, and you will have the satisfaction that you have been able to reach out to at least a few people here and there. Have a wonderful weekend. See you again next Saturday at the same time at 11 o'clock. Bye-bye. I'm not sure if I'm going to be able to do that.
Thank you.